Good afternoon, everybody. My name is Ting Wee. I'm going to touch about Grand Canal for today. So let's just start with some background information about Grand Canal. It's not to be confused with the Venice Grand Canal or the Dublin Grand Canal. It's been around for 1,400 years and is the longest canal in the world right now. It's a major cultural landscape as an ancient engineering monument. It's 1,794 km in length and stretches all the way from Beijing to Hangzhou and connects the Yellow River and the Yangtze River, which is the two largest rivers in Asia. So what is the early history and usage about it? In late spring and autumn period, King Fu Cha of Wu ordered a canal to be built for trading and defense purposes. In case of attacks from the north, he's able to shift troops and military supplies. The main canal system was then built by Emperor Yang of the Sui Dynasty to transport grains and taxes to the capital, and this led formation to the prosperity of the Tang Dynasty and subsequent dynasties due to their salt monopoly. So what is the early construction methods? The dike were built along the Yellow River, with double slipways installed to haul boats. Segments of the canals were dug in a Y shape, and then were built to divert Wen River southwest, four large reservoirs then later built in Shandong. So what are the changes to the Grand Canal? The changes do happen periodically over 14 centuries, as a combination of non-contiguous, artificial cut, canalization, natural rivers also made into a continuous canal. It's widened and straightened later, with bend becoming side channels or cut-off lakes. And of course, the canal initially connecting 18 main cities, each with its special, distinct heritage flag. And however, many ancient dock, mooring point, and warehouses are being raised. And Mr. Zhou Xinghua, vice director of the Grand Canal Museum then, said, "But now they are all the same, 1,000 people with the face of one." So are there any modern uses of the Grand Canal in modern China? Yes, there is. For example, it's the landscaping. Many commercial facilities have been built, an ancient site has been preserved. And this can form a unique timeless fusion of new cityscape. Another mean is transportation. The Grand Canal in Jiangsu province is an example. It stretches 628 km long and is one of the busiest stretch in China. It's an important water transportation artery and it links northern and southern Jiangsu province together. The Grand Canal annually shifts 3 times more cargo than transportation by the rail between Beijing and lower Yangtze region. So what's the water channeling? It's currently being upgraded to serve as eastern route of the South-North Water Transfer Project and it channel flows to reservoir in Tianjin. The construction of the eastern route has begun in 2002 and is supposed to end by 2012. However, water pollution has been affecting the viability of this project. And another good point is the tourism. There are many tourism sites along the Grand Canal, as seen in this photo. The Grand Canal Forest Park has been opened last year and incorporated many natural features, modern features, as well as garden features along the Grand Canal. Other examples are like West Lake of Hangzhou and the Dirty Head Island of Wuxi. It's also a good site for heritage preservation, to preserve ancient housing, and to maintain the town's rich heritage and history. This can give a town's walk a common identity. So what is the Grand Canal in the future? The preservation of the Grand Canal is a major discussion topic for the state administration since 2005 to date. And last year, it has been named the UNESCO World Heritage Site. There are many planned restoration and preservation work ongoing, despite several limitations and difficulties. So what are them? We do have a limited financial budget on no matter what we do. And it's difficult to unite six province government and various local authorities on a common agreement and understanding. There are fierce competition between cities and towns regarding their Grand Canal heritage, as every city or town would like to have their section upgraded or preserved. And this requires cooperation among many central government ministries. And it ranges like from water resources, construction, to transportation or even cultural relics. As I come to an end of my presentation, I'd like to draw some learning points. Preservation of a large heritage site poses a monumental challenge. Pollution can significantly affect our human environment, and effort must be put in place to bring down the pollution before we can tackle any other problem like site preservation. Heritage site preservation can serve economical purpose if well planned with well identified purpose. And now I come to the end of my presentation. Thank you.